one hat, and so the only first question would be some stuff to add. It would be two extra credit questions. One is from Fred Vassia, it says, say, Campbell makes his petition. And the other is from David Ricardo's on for it. So those would be extra credit questions on this test. Get a lot of points, so go for it. Take advantage of this. Today, I want to go just very quickly survey where we're at with elasticity. We started then. This is a kind of difficult part of the course, but I want to give it to you one more time, just a little bit. And finish that out, and we're going to move into new areas. And by the end of today's lecture, we'll probably be in the test 3. Probably. So wherever I hit the material that ends test 2, I'll say draw a line. Everything after that is on test 3, so don't be studying. All right? Don't study that until test 3. And then before that line, it's on test 2. Okay. Remember the golden rule. Firms maximize profits with marginal revenue equals marginal cost. What is marginal revenue? It's a rate of change of the total revenue. Total revenue is price times water. So keep that in mind. And when we look at elasticity, that is about responsiveness. It's how quantities respond to changes in some economic variable. And we looked at three different types of elasticity in the last lecture. Price elasticity of demand, income elasticity of demand, and cross price elasticity. Now, so it's a percentage change in my quantity divided by percentage change in some economic variable. For price elasticity, it's of course the price. For income elasticity, it's going to be substitute income. For cross price, it's going to be substitute to complement. Now, the easiest way to do this, of course, is just go right here, because all these are the same thing. And it'll give you the coefficient of elasticity. That coefficient will have a sign, and it'll have a value. And in business, both of those are extremely important. This is one of the most practical lectures of this entire course. Right? If you're going into business, or you're going to do more applied economics, you have to know this in your sleep. You have to know this inside, outside, back. Now let's start with price elasticity demand one more time. We'll do it quickly because we've already gone over it. We're just changing the price on the y-axis. And what happens is quantities are going to change on the x-axis. And when you plug in the numbers, you get those coefficients. Now, as I said, point estimates are wildly inaccurate. Sometimes it's all you got, so you just got to use what you got. But we don't like to use that. And there is a better mechanism. It's to find the average of all the elasticity points. It's called arc or range elasticity. And I would never make you calculate that. That would be evil to make students calculate that, because it would take you all 50 minutes, 55 minutes, and you need calculators, and you'd be lost. This is something very, you have to be very careful about. I'm just doing this for illustrative purposes. We know if these are the outer points on the elasticities, then the average of all of them in between has to be somewhere between this magnitude and that magnitude. And of course, that's what it is. I should calculate that for you. But I would never make you do that. Now, of course, the most accurate elasticity is you do a first derivative in calculus. First derivative is the instantaneous rate of change. That is elasticity. I will not make you do calculus because it's not required for this course. Okay, now what happens here, things like this, is when people are in business, they run a sale, right? When you see advertisements, they say, buy one, get one free, or 20% off. What they're trying to do is estimate the elasticity of that demand curve. And notice the demand curve always has a negative coefficient. And the reason it's a negative is because there's an inverse relationship between price and quantity. It's a law of demand. Has to be. This were law of supply, would have a positive, because that would be a positive relationship with price. So the sign is already telling you more information. Then we looked at income elasticity. substituting income in place of price. We have the general formula, we get a coefficient, and we know there's two types of goods, normal goods and inferior goods. And remember, this is the way you always remember, so we're always in the positive, positive quadrant. So the right fraction always has to be some positive value, it can't be negative. And then you always start on the left fraction in the denominator, and you work your line. Income goes up for a normal good, people buy more of that good. Income goes down for normal good, they buy less of the good. It's positive. Inferior goods are in opposite directions. Income and demand move in opposite directions. We've already done this on the prior test. Supply and demand, right? Okay, opposite means negative, right? Income goes up for inferior good. Let's say ramen noodles. It's going to be a negative times a positive. You get some negative coefficient, like 26 to the 30th power or something. It's a big number, right? All people just catch that as a joke. Hey, ramen noodles. Income goes down as you get more, you buy more. Notice it's again going to be negative. So substitutes, I mean, inferior goods have negative coefficients, normal goods have positive coefficients. So that's that. And then we have substitutes of complements. And what is this? This is called cross price elasticity. So you're looking at a change of price of substitute. Affects the elasticity for the other one. So what were the substitutes? Butter and margarine? Okay, so we know the right fraction has to be positive. It's always going to be positive. So then if the price of margarine goes up, people start buying more butter. Positive, positive. It has to be positive. Price of margarine goes down, people buy less butter and start buying margarine. Negative, negative. That's positive. Complements move in opposite directions. So opposite is going to be a negative, right? RPs and gas. All right, so we know this has to be a positive. So the price of gas goes up, the demand for RPs goes down, here we go. It's going to be negative. If the price of gas goes down, the demand for RPs goes up, there we go. Negative is going to be negative. And I think we did an example of what might be like a little test question, right? The way you do these is you start crossing out what it can't be. See, because signs tell you important information. So what do signs tell you? What's supplier demand? That's one thing. What else does it tell you? Whether it's normal or inferior, what else does it tell you? Whether it's a substitute or complement. Yeah, so that's part of it. Then we looked at the visuals of the graphs, and now we're going to look at magnitudes. And notice, okay, so this is elasticity right here, percentage change of quantity, percentage change of price. And notice I put all this in terms of percents now, not values in units. And so elastic means small changes in price give you big changes in quantity. A little drop in the price, 10%, man, you sell 20% more. So that's going to be what, 20% divided by what, 10%? Which is going to be 2, right? Got a negative because it's a demand curve. Inelastic means price is not changing quantities very much. It's not responsive. So here we go. Maybe I had a 20% reduction in the price. I sell a little bit more, 10% more, but not proportionate to the change in the price. So it's the percent change in quantity, and it's 10% divided by the change in price, 20%. So it's going to be a negative 0.5. Notice that's less than 1. Inelastic. Then you've got unitary elastic. Everything is equal proportionate rates of trade-off. That's the way you want to understand this. Unitary. Everything is in unison. Maybe you drop your price 20%, you sell 20% more. Maybe you raise your price 50%, you sell 50% less. Well, if that's the case, then it's going to be coefficient 1, not a negative, because it's still going to be down slope. Then you have the perfectly inelastic. This is where demand is invariant. Price, quantity, they're going to have the same. Nothing nothing in the universe ever looks like this, ever. Nothing ever recorded ever looks like this. It's like a uniform. We all know what it looks like, but no one's ever seen one of these. So it's a percentage change in quantity divided by the percentage change in price. So in this example, zero is in the numerator. This would be 20% denominator, so the coefficient would be zero theoretically. Then you got this beast, which we're going to see a little bit later on today. And this one, there is some, a lot of markets that kind of look like this, usually in agriculture, right? It's called perfectly elastic, or sometimes called infinitely elastic. That's usually like, you know, wheat or corn or soybeans, agricultural markets. The way you got to understand this is the demand curve facing the firm is different than the demand curve facing the industry, right? It's different. See, if you think about it, in a perfectly elastic market, you're a speck of dust in a dust storm of supply. You drop a water in an ocean of supply. In other words, Farmer Jones might have 10,000 bushels of wheat. Market price might be $5 a bushel. His total revenue is what, 50,000? If he takes his 10,000 bushels of wheat to the elevator, and the grain elevator says, I'll buy all the wheat you have at $5 a bushel. You got 10,000 bushels of wheat in your truck. There's 1,000 other wheat farmers right behind you with their wheat harvested. It's homogeneous, it's the same as your wheat. And you get up there and everyone's holding up signs, I will sell at $5, I will sell at $5, I will sell at $5. And you're holding up the sign that says, I will sell at $5.01. Well, now you're off the demand curve. You're off the demand curve. Your total revenue goes to zero. You're not going to sell anything, right? The elevator's going to say, move your truck aside. Next, come on up, come on up. I'll buy from all of you, right? See, if you're the only one holding up 501 when everyone else holds up 5, you're not going to sell anything. What if every wheat farmer in the world holds up the price of 501? The total demand in the market doesn't go to zero in quantity, right? There's a difference between everyone charging 501 versus one person charging 501 vis-a-vis all the rest that are charging 5. It's called infinitely or perfectly elastic. We're going to come back to this again at the end of today's lecture. Percentage change in quantity was the complete response, but divided by the percentage change in price. So did this particular farmer have the ability to change the price of wheat? No. So it's percentage change of quantity divided by percentage change of price. There's no change in the price. He's still trying to get 501 going by. So zero's in the denominator. That's undefined. It's undefined because of the limit. There's the okay. So now we got magnitudes. You take like absolute values of these things. This is what? Greater than 1, less than 1, equal to 1. These are the main ones we're. And that tells you whether it's elastic, inelastic, or unitary elastic. So when you see a coefficient of elasticity, there's like enormous amount of information contained in that number. I think I did one last time for you all. Did I show you all how to always get this right on the test? You want to do another one? Yeah, sure. Okay. See if you remember this. Okay. Did I do a positive or negative last time? Negative. I tell you, coefficient of elasticity is going to be 0.9. We'll give you 5 options, 4 which are not going to be true. Don't word out the answer. So what if I say Y is elastic and is inelastic? Okay, so what's the first thing you're going to do? You're going to cover the magnitude. How you say it? What does this automatically exclude? Well, could it be a supply? Yes, just move on. Don't mark that. Could it be a demand? Wrong sign, can't be that. So you're going to mark that off. Can it be a normal good? Can it be a compliment? Wrong side. Can it be an inferior good? No, wrong side. Now you're down to two, aren't you? Then you cover the sign and look at the magnitude. Is that elastic, inelastic, or unitary elastic? That's inelastic. It's less than one, right? So now you go here and say, supply is elastic. No, that's less than one. That's not greater than one. That cannot be the answer. So what are we left with? This has to be the one. Are you with me? How long did that take us? 30 seconds? That kind of question should not take more than 30 seconds on this test. You start to do a process of elimination. If there's any part of that answer that's wrong, it's wrong. Come on to the next one. First, you eliminate all the sign mistakes, then you go back and then you eliminate all the magnitude mistakes. Okay, so now we're getting right to where we kind of left off in that last lecture. And we're talking about price, elasticity, and demand. And remember, we're talking about these three basic regions. There's elastic, inelastic, unitary, elastic. And how price changes based on elasticity will change total revenues. Remember, the firm wants more total revenue. And by definition, total revenue is P times Q. But notice if you change P, it's changing Q. Are you with me? That's where elasticity comes. So if you're facing an elastic demand curve where quantity is responding then greater than proportionate to the changes in price, a little decrease in price can get you a lot more sales. A little increase in price is going to kill your sales big time. So if you're facing an elastic demand curve, you raise the price, you kill your sales. You might raise your price 5%, you lose 20% of your sales. Your total revenue here is going down. Conversely, if it's elastic and you lower your prices a little bit, 5-10%, you might sell 50% more. Your total revenue is going up because quantity is responding in greater than percentage rates of change to the change in price. More than one, coefficients more than one. Inelastic, remember here, things are not responding. Right? Here, big changes in the price doesn't get you that much more on sales. Right? So let's say I double my price of what I'm selling, but it's an inelastic demand that I'm facing. Well, I'll sell a little bit less, but it's all going to be at a much higher price. My total revenues go up. Isn't the magnitude less than one? Quantity is not responding to the change in the price. Revenue's going up. P is changing big. Q is not changing much at all. Conversely, if I lower price on something inelastic, my total revenues goes down. I might drop my price 50%, only sell 5% more. I'm giving a lot of price reduction for very little extra quantity to sell. So notice, elastic change in price and total revenue move in opposite directions. Why? Because quantity is moving greater than the percentage change in price. Inelastic change in price and total revenues move in the same direction. Why? Because quantity is just not responding requisite with the change in price. Then you've got unitary. Remember what that coefficient is always going to be, 1. So you raise your price by whatever percent, 20%, you lose 20% of your sales. No change in your revenues. You lower your price, 5%, you sell 5% more. No change in your revenue. Everything is exactly offsetting. Okay, so far, this is where we're at with elasticity. Let me review it one more time for you, okay? The Gordian Strip textbook has a very good discussion of this. And you need to go through that because they have a really good discussion of elasticity. And in business, this is really important. Now, I don't know if I mentioned this in the last lecture. When you look at elasticity, when you look at just normal sales, when people are price discounting things, let's say this week's sale is going to be this. They're looking at price elasticity of demand, right? If I put some on discount, how much more people going to buy today? Are you with me? They're trying to estimate that demand curve. Okay, that's really important in advertising, price structures and so forth. That's very, very important business. You're trying to do what? Bring people in by those price discounts. And whether it's elastic or inelastic, it won't matter. Businesses need to know that information. They also need to know this. A lot of firms, what they're looking at is the income of their consumers. Does the consumer see this good as a normal good or an inferior good? Now remember, what could be normal to one could be inferior to another, but when you're selling your product to the whole market, whatever cancels out doesn't really matter. What you're concerned about is the net here for your business. So you're going to be looking on the signs of the coefficient, aren't you? And if the sign suggests it's a positive, then you're going to say, wow, if the income of my buyers goes up, I'll probably sell more. If the income goes down, maybe you're in a recession, I'm going to sell a hell of a lot less. They need to know that information in their decisions. Cross-price elasticity is about substitutes and complements, how price change in one affects the quantity of the other. Are you with me? Now, when I was in business, one and three dominated almost all my thinking. I was obsessed with one and three all the time. And one is because, okay, what are we going to put on sale this week? How much are we lowering the price? And number three was actually the most important for me. Now, why is that? Because you need to know, does the consumer see this as a substitute or a complement? Let me give you an example, okay? I used to make my managers of my stores calculate the coefficients so I could determine whether these are substitutes or complements and so forth. And so if I, let's say it's 4th of July, and I put hot dogs on sale, Oscar Mayer hot dogs, $1 a package, maybe I cut 50% price reduction. Are you with me? I know I'm going to sell more hot dogs because I already know what the price elasticity demand was and price prior to sale. That's a good idea. But then the question that I would be asking on cross price elasticity is what happened to the substitutes and the complements of things in the store they can buy when they buy cheaper hot dogs? Are you with me? If you ever go into retail and you have a multi-good thing where you've got thousands of goods and you're putting one thing on discount, how does that change the demand for goods? This is where the money's being lost. Bottom line, this is it. Okay, free business advice. It's amazing, right? So if I say, okay, run the hot dogs, buy one, get one for 50% off. Now think about this. What would be a compliment to a hot dog? Hot dog bun, well, the bun that you would probably put in there. The ketchup you might use, or the relish you might use, or the mustard, right? Yeah. And so then the question is, if I lower the price of hot dogs 50%, how does that change the demand for the hot dog buns? At regular price, without even discounting? Then what's the total amount of revenue I'm bringing in now? My profits here, right? What might be a substitute? Hamburgers, yeah. So if I put the hot dogs and I don't put the hamburgers on sale, and everyone's lining up to buy those hot dogs, put on the grill, guess what? They're probably not buying much of hamburgers. Yeah. And see, I can look at those coefficients and immediately tell whether these are substitutes or complements. Right? If they had a positive, I knew they were substitutes. If they had a negative, I lowered the price of this, I saw a whole lot more of that, I knew those were complementary goods. Are you with me? Then I could then start doing my calculation. How much did I lower my price here? How much more sales did I get of the other things that I'm actually making some money on? And does the combined total of that increase my profits or decrease it? Are you with me? I had learned that in the principles of economics class. When I got into business day one, I knew exactly what I was looking for. Substitutes and complements. I was looking for price elasticity demand, cross price elasticity demand. I cannot tell you, that made me more money than I can count. That's just because now you start zoning in on it. You start saying, wow, I don't want to give away things I don't have to give away. But on the other hand, if I run the hot dog buns on sale, the question is, how many hot dogs would I sell at regular price, vice versa? And remember, just like with point estimates, what can go one direction may not go the other direction. And you have to be careful about these things, right? So that's just a little piece of business advice. You don't want to give away the business to get a few extra sales. On the other hand, you got to be competitive. gotta offer them the best deal, but then you gotta figure out what the hell does the consumer want? What will they use this for? What goes with it that I sell in this business? And what is a substitute one or the other? If I sell this, I'm killing my sales and stuff I actually make some money on. How do I manage that? Okay. Now I want to talk about one more thing in this. So if you go in business, you make a lot of money, you know where you should be paying royalties. Okay, now we're going to talk about priceless debate one more time. And this is the last part of illicit that we're talking about. And your textbook talks about great British economist Alfred Marshall. He was at Cambridge University. He was a student of William Stanley Jevons. You remember Jevons? It was Menger, Jevons, and Walras, remember? The three that came up with the marginal principle, answered with water diamonds, paradox of value, values in your mind subjective, and it's attached at the margin, the next unit that totally revolutionized whole science. So his teacher at Cambridge was William Stanley Jevons. And of course, he in many ways would almost outshine his teacher in the history of economics. Alfred Marshall at Cambridge University would give us the laws or determinants of price elasticity of demand. And there are three. Three of what's called fundamental laws of price elasticity of demand. What makes a demand curve relatively more or less elastic? The quantities are responding greater. Now, here's what Marshall will give us in his treatise. And there are three things. Two are intuitive, one is counterintuitive. Alfred Marshall, and of course all three of these are ceteris paribus. Ceteris paribus, so maybe on the side right, ceteris paribus. Alfred Marshall says the number of available substitutes will be a determinant of price elasticity of demand. Two, ceteris paribus. The percentage of the consumer's budget spent on the good will affect price elasticity of demand. And number three, ceteris paribus, time will affect price elasticity of demand. Now, Alfred Marshall was famous for being the first to draw supply and demand graphs. He actually was one who first drew them. So that automatically made him famous because he actually drew the graphs instead of just doing auction models. But these were so huge, so stellar, earth-shattering. Now let's go through the logic of each because you need to know this. Number one, Marshall is telling us the more substitutes available, all other things being equal, the more elastic the demand curve. More substitutes that are available, the more elastic the demand curve will be. Now, why is that? Let's walk this logic through. If you think about this for a moment, let's say I sell pens. Let's say my pens are a dollar, let's just say. And let's say there's 100 substitutes available to serve your needs to write with. That are not pens. If the price of pens go up just a little bit, where will the consumer switch to? All the other available substitutes, right? So consumers have more options when there's more substitutes available. A little change in the price will have a big change in the quantity on elasticity. So maybe I raise my price of pens from $1 to $1.10. 10% increase in my price, I might lose half of my sales. Why? Because customers are going to do what? Go to something that they can use that isn't a pen, because there's lots of options available. You can think about this in reverse. What if there are very few or no substitutes available? And the price goes up. Aren't you kind of over a barrel? kind of screwed as a consumer, right? You say, well, I'm going to buy this. They just raised the price on me. You're going to look around and say, what else can I use in place of that? You say, there ain't much else out there. Or are you kind of stuck with that? So the fewer the substitutes available, the more inelastic, because you're kind of cornered at this point. That's intuitive. Most people kind of understand that one. If you're a consumer, you like lots of options. Marshall pointed that out. Number two is where Alfred Marshall shows absolute genius. And it's just one little point will make him one of the greatest economists ever to have lived. And here it is. The percentage of the consumer's budget spent on income. This is counterintuitive. It goes against what your intuition is. Alfred Marshall says, ceteris paribus, all things being equal, the greater the percentage of the consumer's budget spent on the good, the more elastic the demand curve. The greater the percentage of the consumer's budget spent on the good, the more elastic the demand curve. Conversely, we can go from the opposite direction. The smaller the percentage of the consumer's budget spent on the good, the more inelastic the demand curve. It's counterintuitive. You're thinking, that doesn't sound right. Oh no, you see why Marshall's a genius here. Now, you see, the things you spend a great percentage of your budget on, you're very price sensitive to that. That's on your radar screen. As Marshall points out, small changes in price of the thing you spend a lot of your money on can hurt you. Can hurt you or benefit you. And so we're always paying attention to things that can hurt us, especially if we spend a lot of our money on that budget, right? And you might think, well, if I spend a lot of money of my budget on something, I need it. Well, yeah, you have needs for everything. The question is the relative elasticity. And that depends, right? Now watch. Here's the Ristisi rule for Alfred Marshall's second principle. This will help you. Here's Ristisi's jingle. We always pay attention to what we pay for. We always pay attention to what we pay for. And the more we pay, the more attention we pay. We always pay attention to what we pay for. And the more we pay, more attention we pay. See, things that are trivial in your budget, you're not watching those prices, are you? Things that make up a big part of what you have to spend your money on, you're watching those prices like a hawk, right? Because you're trying not to be overbearing, right? Now, let me give you a few examples that'll help. Now, how many of you have cars? You spend money in your budget on different things related to your car, don't you? What do you think every year people spend more on? Gasoline to put in the tank of that car, or oil to go in for oil changes? Gas in the car, right? Yeah. The oil changes you might get a couple times a year. Go to Jiffy Lube, buy 4 or 5 quarts of oil, right? Now, how price sensitive are you to these things? Well, Marshall would say, you're going to be more price sensitive to the gasoline than the motor oil. Then why? If the price of gas doubles tomorrow, will you notice that? Oh, hell yes, you're watching that. Every gas station you're driving by, you're looking at what, the price? I do that. I do that now. We all do that, right? We want to see who's got the best deal on the gas, right? Do you do that with motor oil? Do you go into AutoZone or auto parts place or Walmart or Target to go look and check out their motor oil prices? No, not at all. See, because you might spend maybe $50 a year on oil changes, but you might spend that every week going in that gas tank. So you're going to be very price sensitive. You're watching that. And if it's a nickel here or a dime there, man, you're going across the street where it's cheaper, aren't you? Are you going to be going to look at motor oil prices? Oh, hell no. Not at all. See, it's not even on the radar screen if it's not a big part of your budget. But it gets on the radar very quickly when it's a big chunk of your money. You're watching that like a hawk. You're watching it. Very price sensitive to that. And this is absolutely counterintuitive. It just stunned people when he came up with this. And of course, he's absolutely correct. Now, question. Who would be more price sensitive to the motor oil price than the gasoline price? I want you to think about that. Who buys massive amounts of motor oil but buys no gasoline or very little? Who is it? Auto dealership, I mean the auto shops that actually do oil changes? Jiffy Lube, excellent. Now see, do you think Jiffy Lube is watching the motor oil price? As a consumer, as a business consumer, they're going to be looking at, you know, Quaker State and Valvoline and all the different motor oil companies, aren't they? And they're going to be watching it for the pennies. A little change, okay, we'll take another million worth of this and not that. Yeah. Do they buy any gasoline at Jiffy Lube? Yeah, it don't matter. The price could double it. They're watching what hurts them, affects them, right? Are you with me? You as the end consumer, you don't watch the motor oil price because you don't buy much of it. Companies that buys it are watching it like a hawk, right? Are you with me so far? Now you know why Marshall goes down as one of the greatest of all times. Let me give you another one that I can tell you absolutely positively is a case from the grocery industry, which I know just a little bit about. Now, what do you think people are going to pay attention to? Staple items that they buy every week, throw into baskets, there's like 30, 40 items people buy on average every week. What are those things they buy every week? They spend a large chunk of their grocery budget on. Well, I can break it down for you. It's usually bread, milk, coffee, sugar, laundry detergent, soap powder, toilet paper, you know, things you buy every week. Are you with me? Now, then there are things you buy maybe once a year. Now, let me give you an example. Toothpicks. You know, a little box of toothpicks, 1,000 toothpicks. What do you think people are more price sensitive? Price of bread and milk, right? If the price of bread and milk go up a nickel, all hell breaks loose. Everyone's like, what happened? Because they're seeing that price every day, every week, every time you go to the store, looking at the bread and the milk and the meat. And they're looking at those prices. How often do they buy a box of toothpicks? Once a year? So the price of toothpicks doubles from $1 to $2 a little box. Not on the radar screen, you see it? I don't hurt that much. Price of milk or bread doubled. Oh, yeah, that hurts you, right? So the things you're always putting in that basket, you're watching all the time. Consumers are what? They know. I know what that coffee is. I know what the sugar price is. I know because I buy it every single week. And I can see when that goes a little bit, man, I'm looking for alternatives. I'm looking for someone else that hasn't raised their price on these things. Are you with me? Alfred Marsh is absolutely correct. Let me give you one more example. Now, in about 3 weeks, we're going to be coming up against a holiday. And on that particular holiday, 3 or 4 weeks, 100 million Americans will buy something. It's called a turkey. Are you with me? Now, they're going to buy turkeys for Thanksgiving. This is the one, I always like to say, it's the 1 week of the year. Every grocery store can make more money than they count, and that's the 1 week of the year. Why do they all lose money on that? Because they're going to loss leader, what, the turkey? Guess what price everyone is fixated on when they go shopping for Thanksgiving dinner? The biggest value item going in the basket, right? You always pay attention to what you pay for, and the more you pay, the more attention you're paying, right? So they're looking at that turkey price. You know, what's Shoppers turkey price? What's Aldi's turkey price? What's Safeway's turkey price? What's the turkey price of Giant? Right? They're looking at that. A few pennies difference is what? Could probably steer people to do what? Go to where it's cheaper? Yeah. So they're going to lose money, guaranteed. They'll lose, you know, $10, $12 on a turkey. Loss leader. It's like, gift? Please shop here. Right? Because if you don't lower your price when everyone else is giving the turkeys, what happens to you? You're out of business. Meet them. So you gotta be competitive with this. Now, what is not a big dollar value item in that Thanksgiving turkey dinner basket. Well, I can tell you right now what people are not price sensitive to: pumpkin pie spice. You know, the spice that you put in the pumpkin pie. Now, here's what'll happen. You say people might have half of the jar, little jar of pumpkin pie spice left over from last year. And they say, oh, I want fresh pumpkin pie spice. It'll taste better. And then they're gonna pay like $5 for a little tiny little bottle of pumpkin pie spice. Or send them in their clothes, they'll pay like $5, a little tiny bottle, right? Guess what's not on sale that week? Pumpkin pie spice, right? Yeah, and people say, yeah, it's expensive, but you know, it's for pumpkin pie. They might have that price doubled for that week for pumpkin pie spice. While they're giving away the turkey below their cost. Are you with me? Hoping you'll buy enough of this other stuff. Just great. Are you with me? Yeah, this is where cross-price elasticity and all that kind of stuff comes into play big time. So you keep your customers happy, you give them good discounts, but yet you don't throw away all your money trying to buy their shopping at your store. Yeah. Alfred Marshall gives us this. We're always price sensitive to the prices that can hurt us, because those are obvious and on the radar screen and in our face all the time, and we're watching. Any little change, we're starting to think, how do I rearrange this somehow? How do I rearrange my affairs? Which gets to the third principle Alfred Marshall tells us, is time makes all demand curves more elastic. Ceteris paribus, time makes everything more elastic. That's why you don't ever have any perfectly inelastic things. It's time. Now, just as an aside, here's another Restici rule. When you look at a coefficient of elasticity, you have to remember this is measuring what has happened over time. They changed the price, they changed the quantities over a period of time. It could be a week, could be a month, could be a year, whenever you calculate those elasticities. Elasticity coefficients are not like baked in the cake. They're always a function of time. So whenever someone says, well, here's the coefficient of elasticity for shoes, you say, over what time horizon? That matters. Notice that language, over what time horizon? Time makes everything more elastic. Now, let's just go right back up here. What does time give every consumer an ability to do? Rearrange their affairs to do what? Look for more substitutes. Three feeds into one. What could be highly inelastic on the first day could be perfectly elastic if you give it 6 months or a year, right? So these coefficients are not like some fixed in granite thing. It depends. How much time are we talking about? Let me prove this to you. Why Marshall's such a genius here. Take gasoline. Now, a lot of people think gasoline is inelastic. And I hear people do this. They'll say, well, gasoline's inelastic. That's not true. It is highly elastic. But it depends on, what did I just say? Time. Everything is elastic if you give it enough time. Now, let me start. Let's say, for the sake of argument, the market demand for gasoline is this first curve. And let's say the price of gasoline today is at $2, and the quantity people are buying at $2 is Q. Are you with me? Now let's say overnight something happens in the Middle East, maybe the oil is shut off, and the price goes from $2 to $10 overnight. You wake up in the morning, you're driving to school, and all of a sudden they're changing all the gas prices. From 2 to 10, 2 to 10, 2 to 10, all of them going to 10. Are you with me? That's signaling you what something really bad happened. Now it's in your orbit, your radar screen. You're paying attention to this. Well, you might say, well, but today I got to get to school and I'm almost out of gas. Right? You'll buy a little S, maybe X. It's not proportionate to the change in price. That would still be very inelastic. You say, well, I still got to get to work today. I still got to get to school. But maybe instead of buying a full tank of gas at that higher price, what might you buy? A couple gallons to get you through and hope maybe next day or so things will change. A couple of gallons. Now, if that price sticks, let's say this goes on, the first things you're going to be cutting back on this first part is you may buy less and you can keep less in the gas tank, right? What else might you do? You might say, you know what, I was going to take a trip today. I was going to go to Virginia Beach. I don't think I'm going today. I think I'm going to wait a few weeks when the price comes down. Are you with me? Isn't that the same as not using gasoline? Sure, it's a way of buying less quantity. But in the very, very short run, it's not going to be a big amount, but it's something. And let's say this goes on, that $10 price sticks. And let's say we're 2 weeks into this or a month into it. You're waiting for that price to come down. It ain't coming down. It's there. It's still at 10. Watch what's going to happen to this demand curve. It's going to start this pivot. It's going to start this pivot. It's going to become progressively more elastic. Now this is going to be the demand curve. And why will this happen? So now the quantity reductions from QM, from Q to M, not just Q to X, is more quantity that is being not used because of that price. So how might people reduce their usage of gasoline? Well, they might carpool and they say, hey, we're both going to school together, we live a few blocks apart, why don't we ride together? So each of us take a car, ride share. Don't people do that? Yeah, well, else might they? They might say, well, I'm taking the metro today. I ain't gonna refill my tank and spend $200 to fill my tank up. I'll just ride the metro if I can get it. Ride the bus, the metro, something. Is that a substitute for using gasoline? Yeah. See, it still may be relatively inelastic, but notice as time goes on, it becomes more and more inelastic. Now, let's say that price sticks. Now we're here a month, month and a half down the road, and it's still $10 a gallon. Now you're facing this demand curve, D-double. Now what might people do? Well, on any given day, about 40, 50,000 people trade in their old cars and buy brand new cars in the United States. What's the first question that's going to be asked every auto dealership? What's gas mileage? Or guess what they're going to be doing? Can I buy an electric? Isn't that a substitute for using gasoline? Absolutely. So that's the first question they're going to say, what's the gas mileage? Right, are they going to want to buy bigger cars or smaller cars? Smaller. It adds substitute for using gasoline. Yeah. Now it's becoming much more elastic. Now the quantity effect, which was originally from Q to X, then Q to M, is not going to be from Q to J. Now you're looking at something that is relatively elastic here. It might take a few months to get there. Are you with me? It's not going to happen overnight. You've got time to rearrange your affairs, find your substitute. Now, it could go on, let's say 6 months down the road, it's still at $10 a gallon. Watch this. At that price, now you're into this demand curve, which almost is perfectly elastic. Now watch this. So now the quantity reduction between that same price is going to get you Q to Z. Quantity is going to decline vastly more than that price went up. So how might people do this? Well, another way of using less gasoline is relocating, right? People might move closer to their job, right? Students at George Mason that commute, maybe from Maryland, D.C., guess where they're going to be moving to? Campus, if they can. Guess what? Maybe somewhere in Fairfax. So they can ride the Q bus, or the university bus line, whatever. Or they'll try to get to a place that's on a subway line that can get them close to here. Oh, sure. Yeah, so if you think about it, if tomorrow the price of gas goes from $2 to $10 a gallon, you're not moving tomorrow. But you don't have to move tomorrow. You're going to make substitutions. And you're going to continuously make substitutions. Time is going to give you an ability to do what? Rearrange your affairs. So you can economize, as Megger might say. Use less of that good and find other options. So we do see that. Eventually, people relocate jobs, they'll work from home, they'll move to campus, or close to campus, with walking distance. All of those procedures do what? Use less gasoline. So the coefficient to price elasticity demand might be very small. It might be negative 0.1 here tomorrow. And then over time, it could be almost perfectly elastic. But it's a question of how long we're talking about. can you find those alternatives? Can you find those substitutes? And people always are creative in finding substitutes. You always pay attention to what you pay for. And that's going to force you to start thinking, okay, if I'm not doing this, how else can I get to where I need to go without using gasoline? Let's start rearranging, let's start rearranging, let's start rearranging. And that process never stops. So whenever I hear people say, well, gasoline is inelastic, the first question I say back to them is, over what time horizon? Show me your coefficient, tell me the time. Is this 1 day, 1 month, 1 year, 10 years? Oh, you're talking 5, 10 years, you're talking about perfectly elastic. I mean, this is like infinitely elastic. So you gotta know the time horizon. Because that's telling you how much time people have had to make changes to their behavior. Does that make sense? Alfred Marshall did this, all three of these. Now you know why he's one of the greats of all time. And really it was the second one that was so stunning. Because we think that the things we spend a lot of money on are in the last, as you pointed out. Things we spend a lot of money on, we're watching like a hawk all the time, waiting for little changes so we can change our behavior. It's this third one that gives us the ability to find those substitutes. Okay, that's it on elasticity, which is really kind of the hardest part of this part of the course. And now I want to talk about something else. We're talking about laws of economics. We've already talked about laws of supply and demand. And now we've talked about the law of comparative advantage. We've talked about Marshall's law of the determinants of price elasticity. There's three different factors that make something more or less elastic. And now we're going to look at another law of economics. And this is called the law of diminishing marginal returns. Law of diminishing marginal returns. And this was first really discovered in the classical school of economics, even though they didn't even know what marginals were. But they had the basic concept correct. And this has been observed in virtually every market we've ever seen. And this is a production law. Write that down. It's a production law. And usually people mess this one up, and I'm going to prove it to you just a little bit. Now, remember when I talked about fixed costs and variable costs in business, there are also what are called fixed inputs and variable inputs. There are fixed inputs and variable. So you think about a fixed factor of production and a variable factor. So if you're producing more, you get more variable inputs, right? So if I got a business, I produce more output, I probably hire more people. Work in my company, produce more output. That's a variable input, right? And the factory itself is fixed. But what varies is how many people I got working in that factory. So there's fixed costs and variable costs. There's fixed inputs and variable inputs. So just remember, fixed inputs, write this down, are invariant to production. Variable inputs move with production. That's point number one. Now, you've heard me say today about short runs and long runs, so we got to make another definition. There's a short run in economics and a long run in economics. And we're going to get to the law of diminishing returns, how this all plays out. What do we mean by short run and long run? What does that mean? It's not some fixed quantity of time. All right, it's not like, you know, 3 days, 2 minutes. Because when you think about businesses, businesses are all different. And what could be a short run for General Motors could be a long run for a McDonald's, Burger King. So you have to have a definition that deals with the fixed and variable factors of production. That is kind of all-purpose general definition that explains their decision-making. Here's the definition of the short run. The short run is defined, write this down, as that time horizon, where all inputs, are not economically variable. The short run is defined as that time horizon where all inputs are not economically variable. In parentheses, right, something is fixed in the short run. That's why it's a short run. Something is fixed in the short run. That's what makes it a short run. The long run is defined, you've used ditto marks, it helps. The long run is defined as that time horizon where all inputs are economically variable. That time horizon where all inputs are economically variable. In parentheses, put nothing is fixed in the long run. Nothing is fixed in the long run. So notice there's no actual time that says this has to be short run, long run. It's about the decision makers, decisions given what you have control over versus what you don't have control over. And with enough time, you got control over everything. In the short run, you may not have control over everything. Okay, so we got fixed factors of production and variant fixed inputs. Variable factors must move with production. And we know in the short run, by definition, something's fixed. Something's constraining. And we know in the long run, nothing is fixed. Everything can be changed if you give them enough time. Now let's get to the law of diminishing marginal returns. So we put all these pieces together. This was, as I said, first noticed in the classical school of economics. It's a production law, and people have seen this over and over and over again. And this is one of those laws of economics. Everyone thinks they know, but they don't know. How many have heard someone say, well, that's a law of diminishing returns? We've heard that phrase. 99.9% of people that use the phrase law of diminishing returns have no clue what they're talking about. And I'm going to prove it to you. Here's the definition of the law of diminishing marginal returns. Write this down. The law of diminishing marginal returns states, with the fixed input, and successive additions of a variable input, to that fixed factor, with the fixed input, and successive additions of a variable input to that fixed factor, at some point, the rate of output growth of the variable input begins to decline. Let me repeat it all. With the fixed input and successive additions of a variable input to that fixed factor, at some point, the rate of output growth of the variable input begins to decline. You need to memorize that. I would write it on a little note card, put it under your pillow and sleep on it, read it, put it up, tape it up in the mirror in the morning, read it every day, because it'll come back over and over again in this course. Now, this law is a production one. Did anybody want me to repeat it one more time? So I can never tell whether they've all written it down or not. Let me repeat it. The law of diminishing marginal return states with a fixed input and successive additions of a variable input to that fixed factor. At some point, the rate of output growth of the variable input begins to decline. A big mouthful, but you don't get used to say that. Let me give you an example. I'm going to show you how to make a lot of money. I'm going to show you right now. When someone says, oh, that's a law of diminishing marginal return, you've got your little definition written down, say, give me the definition. And they won't know what the hell they're talking about. A confusion with diminishing marginal utility, which is on the demand side. This is on the production side. Here we go. Let's say we have Farmer Jones. And he's got fixed factors of production. Maybe it's a piece of land, maybe 1 acre of land. He's got variable factors of production. And that might be the workers that he's gonna hire to work the land. So you got fixed and variable factors of production. Fixed and variable factors of production. Now they're gonna be growing. So here we're gonna have quantity, we're gonna have total output. And that's gonna be in terms of bushels of wheat. All right, now let's think about this for a minute. Let's say Farmer Jones has an acre of land, that's fixed. And let's say he doesn't farm it, he doesn't hire anybody to farm it, nobody ever touches that piece of land. How much wheat's coming off that land? Nothing. Okay. So let's say he decides, I'm gonna hire some people to work my land. So he hires the first guy. Says, here's what I want you to do. So this is the land right here, right? This is the land. And he says, I want you, this person, he's gonna hire the first person. He says, I want you to just scatter some seeds around. And when this stuff grows, I want you to harvest it. Okay, so he hires a guy. And let's say the guy has 10 bushels of wheat he harvests. What's the marginal productivity of the first guy? 10. Yeah, his efforts contributed to 10. Scattering some seeds around, harvest what grows. All right. And what if he says, okay, this is good. Let me help you out a little bit. Let's hire another person. We're going to do a little comparative advantage and division of labor like David Ricardo might teach us. How about this? How about you till the soil and make nice rows, and you plant the seeds? Instead of just scattering them and let the birds eat and all this, we're going to have them now in the dirt. We're going to have nice rows, grow more, and harvest more. Okay. So now that end of that year comes, they have two people working that field, and they harvest 22 bushels of wheat. What's the marginal productivity of the second worker? 12. He had a 12 to total output. This is good. This is good. I like this. Next season, he says, okay, hire another one. He's got 3. He says, you till the soil. You plant the seeds. I want you out there watering the plants and maybe throwing some fertilizer. Okay. Now he gets 30 bushels. What's the marginal productivity of the third guy? 8. Good. Good. See, you're all learning. So let's keep going with this. So he knows it's a fixed factor. He says, let's hire a fourth guy. You till the soil. You plant the seeds. You water. You put down the fertilizer. Maybe the fourth guy will put down herbicide to kill the weeds. So that way the plants grow bigger and stronger. 5 bushels. What's his marginal? Good. So he says, let's hire higher level. Number five, it says, you till the soil, you plant seeds, you water, you fertilize, you put herbicide, you put down some insecticide because the bugs are eating some of this. What's the marginal productivity of the fifth guy? Let's keep going. Higher in the sixth guy. You plant the, you till the soil, plant seeds, water, fertilize, herbicide, insecticide, you are going to run the deer off that might come and eat some of this. Well, now they're kind of bumping into each other. Maybe the total output goes to 36. What's that marginal productivity? Negative one. Do one more. What if we did another one? Watch. He says, you till the soil, plant seeds, you put fertilizer, water, insecticide, herbicide, you're chasing the deer away. I want you to be a scarecrow. Stand there and keep the birds away. They might want to eat some of this. When you're taking up some space, it could be growing this stuff. So now it's 32. What happened there? I just lost 4 bushels of wheat, right? Okay, now I want everyone to participate. Show of hands. Everyone look up here. Tell me when the law of diminishing marginal returns kicks in. Let's see, show hands. How many say between 1 and 2? Between 2 and 3? Between 3 and 4? Between 4 and 5? Between 5 and 6? Between 6 and 7? How many did not raise your hand? It's okay to be wrong. I say this. Now, I just said 90% of people who say this law of diminishing returns don't know what they're talking about. I just gave you the definition. See, here's where the law of diminishing marginal returns kicks in, right there between 2 and 3. Most people put it down here. Are you with me? And I just gave you the definition. Read your definition. Just start looking at that definition. You need to write that down, put it under your pillow, say it 20 times every night. With a fixed input and successive additions of a variable input, at some point, the rate of output growth of the variable input begins to decline. Here is the mistake you made, and I will promise you, the others will make it. They're confusing negative returns with diminishing returns. Never make that mistake. Never, ever make that mistake. See, notice what happened to the rate of output growth of the variable input. Notice, it more than doubled. Did it more than double again? No, it's still growing, but what? At a slower and slower rate. So down here is what's called negative returns. Now, what's this part before? Well, this is called increasing returns. So where is diminishing returns? It's in between these two, isn't it? This is diminishing, but positive. See, so people that say, well, that's a law of diminishing returns, usually are inferring negative returns. That's not diminishing. Diminishing returns begin right here. Or they'll confuse it with diminishing marginal utility, which is on the demand side. So I'm showing you how to make a lot of money. I wish I would have made everybody make a bet. And I just gave you the definition. That one word, rate, changes everything, right? Now, let me just finish up. I still got 4 or 5 more minutes. What happens to companies that get caught down here? If you're in negative returns, you're paying people to do what? Lose you revenues. What's that called to a company? Pay somebody to lose them revenues. It's called bankruptcy. You're not a company for very long, right? So do companies want to get trapped in negative returns? No. So what happens is they do what's called downsizing. How many have heard of downsizing? They're trying to get the hell out of negative returns, aren't they? They're trying to scale this thing back. Here, you're going to keep expanding, aren't you? You got increasing returns. There we go. So we've got negative returns down there. You've got increasing returns. This is the equilibrium of the market. Everything in the market gravitates to the point of diminishing but positive returns. Law diminishing marginal returns. Any questions? So if you've got the definition written down, you get someone to say that's a law diminishing returns. So now you've got them on the hook and you say $100, you don't know what you're talking about. And you have the definition, have the definition, yes. Yeah, diminishing but positive returns. Smaller firms will grow here. Bigger firms are going to do what? Retrench and shrink and downscale, downsize. So this is the equilibrium of the marketplace. That's the center of gravity of a production, so to speak, as Megger might say. Everything gravitates towards diminishing but positive returns. So as long as it's a positive return, there's still gain there. Never confuse a negative with diminishing. Two different things. Conceptually completely different. Are you with me? And I promise you, you will make so much money out of just getting them to bet. They don't know what they're talking about, especially econ majors that just kind of cruise through their degree, not paying attention. And they see the word diminishing, or maybe they'll say marginal, they mention marginal utility. No, that's on the demand side. And you say, I bet you don't know what you're talking about, and there's $100, because I got the definition. And you'll take the money. It won't be your friend. But then again, you'll have your money. That's all that matters, right? You say, if you want to be my friend, get your money back. That's a stupid thing. You don't know what you're talking about. Does that help? See you all on Monday.